Oh, hi. It's me, Professor Gerding, and this is Fun at One, the show where I use my psychology office hours to play games with my psychology students. But today's different. Today, we're going to lecture all about sleep and dreams. 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 I love talking about this stuff. You know why? Because I love psychology. Now, I know that I said previously that we would talk, we would use this week for multiplayer games, but we're going to save that till next week because I realize this week is going to be a test week, and a lot of you students want to know all about Chapter 4 from the OpenStax textbook, so we're going to talk about that. I see Darnell's here. I see Ruben's here, and Ruben, you're sick. I hope this maybe cheers you up and makes you feel better. Stomach flu! Disgusting. Oh my goodness. And if you're tuning in to learn all about Chapter 4 and consciousness and its variations, that's Chapter 4 in the OpenStax psychology textbook. We use the OpenStax textbook. Why? Because it's free. It's totally available online. If you're not using it right now, you can just go ahead and Google OpenStax psychology, and it'll take you right there. That's OpenStax, OpenStax. Without further ado, let's dive into the chapter that many students have told me is their favorite chapter. Why is their favorite chapter? Because we have so many stories about our dreams and our sleep. It's this mysterious phenomenon. Why do we sleep? Why do we have dreams? What do they mean? Do dreams mean something? And so I'm asking you, share with me some of your interesting dreams. For instance, have you ever had recurring dreams? Dreams that happen again and again to the point where you're like, oh, this dream, I know what's going to happen. While you're in the dream, you recognize that this dream is a dream that you've had before. I'm realizing now that my glasses are slightly smudged, so I'm going to clean them in front of you. What about nightmares, right? Dreams that have gone bad. Ah! What kind of nightmares have you had? For me, I haven't had any of the traditional monster nightmares that you may think of children having in a long time. In fact, maybe this is a little too much information about your old Professor Gerding, but when I have nightmares, they're always social situations. They have to do with relationships. If monsters show up in my dreams, that there's a good, fun dream. Uh-oh, zombies! Awesome. Kind of like those dreams. But what about dreams with meaning? For instance, let's suppose you have a dream where your teeth are falling out. What does that mean? Does that mean someone's gonna die soon? Oh my! There's also this weird phenomenon that happens during dreams. Like, maybe you are paralyzed. You ever have sleep paralysis? Oh my goodness, that's amazing. You wake up and you can't move? What about sleepwalking? You ever done some sleepwalking? So many unusual things happen while we're trying to sleep. What about wetting the bed? Urinesis! Oh my. Hopefully we have time to talk about all of these things. Because today, we're talking about consciousness and sleep. We won't have time to talk about dreams and other activity. We won't have time to talk about memory consolidation, hypnosis, or meditation. And we won't be talking about drugs, at least not today. Today, I hope we cover consciousness and sleep, the stages of sleep. And if we don't finish it all today, consciousness and sleep, we're going to go tomorrow as well and finish it up with part two, all about our dreams. But monster dreams? Yeah, they're fun, Ruben. I enjoy me some monster dreams. Because, I mean, it means we're like living in this fantasy world where things are real and anything can happen. But let's get into it. Let's talk about circadian rhythms. Circadian rhythms in our consciousness. You ever notice that you're sleepy about the same time every day? Or that you have to go poo about the same time every day? Or you ever do one of these things where maybe you take a nap or you wake up and you think, you know what? I think it's like 10:35. And then you look at your watch and you realize, boom, right on the money. It's almost as if you can tell what time it is before you even look at the clock. How are we able to do these things? Why are we hungry, thirsty, definitely tired about the same time every day? Why is it we can tell what time it is without looking at a clock? It has to do with our circadian rhythms. For me, my big nap time is around 2:30. Around 2:30 p.m., it's as if these little invisible pixies or brownies show up and they just start shooting me with these darts. They hit me in the neck and I get really sleepy. So what do you think your old Professor Gerding does around 2:30 every day? Take a nap, Ski. Take a nap. Darnell says that Darnell did some sleepwalking when he was a child. Well, maybe this will get you a little bit more excited about what we're going to learn. You know what's interesting about sleepwalking? You know who sleepwalks? Everybody. Everybody sleepwalks. What? What? Yep, everybody sleepwalks. What do you mean? We'll get to it. We'll get to it. Here's a little preview. The reason that everybody sleepwalks is that we have this misconception of sleepwalking commonly. Commonly, people think sleepwalking looks like something like... like they've seen the movie Step Brothers with Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly. That's not what sleepwalking looks like. Sleepwalking looks like someone's awake and they're walking around. So what is sleepwalking then? Well, I'll tell you coming up. Oh, let's get into it. But let's get back to circadian rhythms, right? Circadian rhythms. It's not lies, Ruben. Ruben, you sleepwalk too. Here we go. Circadian rhythms. Oops, did a little glitch there. So this is the cycle rhythm that's roughly about 24 hours long. It's actually a little bit longer than 24 hours because in the absence of time cues, it goes over 24 hours. But it helps us with our biological processes as far as like body temperature, cortisol secretion, sleep and wakefulness cycles. It's as if we have this internal clock. And every day, ding, it resets. And it resets. And at different points in the day, your body says, bing, okay, we got to be more awake. Bing, okay, we got to have more cortisol in our system. Bing, oh, and maybe we need to take a nap-ski. This is the idea of circadian rhythms. And that's how we're able to tell time. So we need our circadian rhythms reset every day. Ding. So I'm asking you, what do you think resets our circadian rhythms? What hits that reset button on that stopwatch that allows us to function throughout the day? Now, a lot of people say sleep, right? You go to sleep and it ding, resets your circadian rhythms. Nope, it is not sleep that resets your circadian rhythms. It is the biggest, most natural time cue that you have available to you. And what is the biggest, most natural time cue that's available to you? Well, that is the sun. That's right. Sunlight is what resets your circadian rhythms. So when you first wake up in the morning and you first look at that sun, ding, it resets your circadian rhythms. So the question is, what happens if you don't see the sunlight at the appropriate time? What happens if, I don't know, you're in a different time zone and the sun's rising at a significantly different time? What happens to our circadian rhythms? They get all thrown out of waxy. Oh no. And how does that make us feel? Not so good. So what do we call it when our circadian rhythms don't reset appropriately? We call that jet lag. Yeah, jet lag. But jet lag is not just for travelers. The reason that travelers experience jet lag is again because you're experiencing a different time zone. You Indiana Jones flew to a different time zone and now the sun's waking you up at a different time or too late, whatever. And therefore, you feel all sorts of side effects. But what's the problem if you live in Alaska? Alaska? Well, have you seen the movie 30 Days of Night? It's a vampire movie, and vampires have an idea like, hey, let's go party in Alaska where they got 30 days of night over there. So what happens with their circadian rhythms? Do they get all thrown out of whack? Yep. So what do they need to do? Well, they have ultraviolet lampshades. Basically, it's like windowsills that have timers on them with the shutters. So it has this artificial sunrise that happens in their homes using ultraviolet light. It's It's pretty interesting stuff. So jet lag has all of these side effects, and again, it's not just for travelers. Physical fatigue, mental fatigue, depression, irritability, disrupted sleep. The best way I can describe jet lag isn't with words, but with the sound. Jet lag, and you've probably experienced it before, jet lag feels like this. That's jet lag in a sound. You're just, it's like you're tired, but you're not. You're achy, but nothing really. You didn't work out. It's just an awful feeling. You feel like a scab. Jet lag. And that can happen if you work third shift, graveyard shift. If you stay up all night. You ever do that? You stay up until like 5 a.m. and then you just realize, well, this day's ruined because I'm just going to be experiencing jet lag all the next day. So that's jet lag. But sunlight, being the reset button for the biological clock, needs a specific neurological, physiological part of your brain that is the reset button. So what is that reset button? The reset button is your suprachiasmatic nucleus, gesundheit, also known as the SCN. The suprachiasmatic nucleus is the cluster of neurons in your hypothalamus that governs the timing of circadian rhythms. So when light goes in through your eyeballs, it reaches the suprachiasmatic nucleus, and then ding, it resets your circadian rhythms. That's connected to your hypothalamus, right? Your hypothalamus, that's part of your brain that is beneath your thalamus. And if you learned all about anatomy and physiology, especially of the brain, your neurology, then you know all about the tasks that the hypothalamus are responsible for, the four Fs, feeding, fighting, fleeing, and fornicating. Oh my. But anyway, enough about that. That's another chapter. Let's get back to this chapter, chapter 4, as we get through this. And by the way, time out. You can tell we're in chapter 4 because if you look in the upper right corner, it has a number 4. But you notice those little icons there. The first one is the icon for circadian rhythm. So if you're skipping around this video, if you're not watching it live, you know that we're talking about circadian rhythms. If we have that first icon lit up, which is right now. And then the next icon is the sheep icon. And if that one's lit up, you know we're talking about sleep and the stages of sleep, etc. And the last one's about drugs, but we're probably not going to talk about drugs in this video or the next. But anyways, we got melatonin on the screen. What the heck is melatonin? Remember how I talked to you about the pygmies that shoot those invisible darts into my neck that make me tired? Well, melatonin is the hormone of the pineal gland, and that produces sleepiness. Maybe you've heard of Bob Marley's Mellow Brew. I'm not even sure if they still make that stuff. But Bob Marley's Mellow Brew is supposed to mellow you out. But it's not an alcoholic beverage, even though it's like looks like it's in an alcoholic can. But what in Bob Marley's Mellow Brew makes you so tired? Well, if you read the ingredients, it says melatonin. Oh my goodness. And then even has a warning on the cans that says, warning, don't drink this and operate heavy machinery, even though it is not alcoholic. What's so dangerous about it? Well, it has melatonin. It makes you sleepy. Some people take melatonin pills to help them sleep at night. But wait a second. If melatonin is a hormone made by the pineal gland of the brain, how are they getting it in Bob Marley's mellow drink? How are they getting brain juice, basically, in there? Or in their pills? Sheep's brains, mostly. They may have some synthetic, but for the most part, sheep's brains, so. That's why you can't do Bob Marley's Mellow Brew if you're a vegan, because it has melatonin, and then you're drinking sheep's brains, that kind of thing. So interesting stuff, melatonin. Here's something else that's pretty interesting about melatonin. The release of melatonin is suppressed by sunlight, talking, and walking. So if you're really tired, one of the best ways to stay awake is to have sunlight hitting your eyes, be talking and walking. It's also why people experience SAD, SAD, seasonal affective disorder, is because they have very sensitive melatonin levels. And in the wintertime, especially if you're from Cleveland, you don't get a lot of sun in the wintertime. That's why a lot of people get pretty depressed. So if you have seasonal affective disorder and you live in Cleveland, you should probably move. Or you get one of those ultraviolet lamps that makes you prevent the excessive release of melatonin. Yeah, fascinating stuff, fascinating stuff. It's also why your teacher has no problem staying awake in lectures where you as students do have a problem staying awake during your lectures at school because you're just sitting down, you're not talking, you're not walking, but the professor is, so it's not really fair. So the professor should empathize a little bit and have you stand up and talk and give you breaks and all that jazz. But anyway, here we go. Tony's here! Hey, Tony! So good to see you in print above me. I hope you're doing fantastic, Tony. All right, let's go on from melatonin. And here are some examples of the typical human circadian rhythms. Pretty interesting stuff when we look over here. For instance, this is what's really interesting. Remember I said my sleepy time is about 2:30 in the afternoon? Apparently I'm not alone. You've heard of that, like, got that 3 o'clock feeling from 5-hour energy drink? That's because the average person has peak melatonin levels around 3 a.m. and 3 p.m. The average person feels like they need to take a nap around 3 p.m. Pretty interesting stuff. If you're going to get tortured, my goodness, you should ask to be tortured around 4 p.m. Hey, if you're going to torture me, please do it at 4 p.m., please. Worst time to do it would be 4 a.m. because lowest sensitivity to pain is around 4 p.m. Peak sensitivity to pain, 4 a.m. Best time to torture someone? 4 a.m. There is the microfilm. Ah! All right. But there you go. That's circadian rhythms. Let's move on from circadian rhythms and talk about the stages of sleep. Oh, man. I love me some sleep. That's where I'm a Viking. Now, there's stages of sleep and there's brainwaves. So as we talk about this, you're going to have to understand more about the brain and how it functions because we have very specific stages of sleep. And one of the identifiers for different stages of sleep are the brainwaves. So we're going to do a little stroll down brainwave park while we learn about brainwaves, and then we're going to talk about the different stages. So let's talk about the four basic groups of brainwaves. There's actually another one, gamma, but don't worry about that. For all intents and purposes, we're just worrying about beta, alpha, theta, delta. Brainwaves we see from electroencephalography, EEG. That's when you put all the electrodes on your head and you get to see people's brainwaves. And there's different elements to a wave. And hopefully I'm patronizing you at this point. Hopefully you already know this. There's the wavelength. How wide is the wave, right? That's also known as frequency. But then there's amplitude. And amplitude is the wave's height. Now, the way I remember that, here's a little pro tip from Professor Gerding. When I write wavelength, I make a really wide W, like wave length. And when it has that really wide W, that's a reminder that it's measuring the width. And then with amplitude, when I write amplitude, I write a really high A. Amplitude, A. So a really tall A. So amplitude's height, wavelength's width. You don't need to know that for the test, but it helps you understand brainwave. Because typically, the quicker the frequency, meaning the shorter the wavelength, the more, the faster it is, if you will, the more awake you are. And typically, the longer the wavelength, the wider the wavelength, the slower the frequency, the more sleepy someone is. Ugh. And so our widest wavelength, our sleepiest wavelength, you can see right here is delta. Like those are really wide waves. But what's interesting is the wider they go, typically, there are exceptions, the higher they go. So delta also has really high amplitude, right? But anyways, beta waves is when you're wide awake and paying attention. So those are really quick. Delta, slow, wide waves. Beta, and as you start getting drowsy, you get alpha waves. You ever struggle to stay awake during class doing this move where you're like, you're actually taking notes with your pen and you look at your notebook and there's scribbles because you're falling asleep while you're writing. That's a lot of alpha. And then theta is typically when you fall asleep. You know you're asleep if a majority of your brainwaves are theta. And then as you fall asleep, you get deeper and deeper and deeper into sleep and eventually get to delta, the very slow waves of sleep. Now keep in mind, brainwaves have a whole bunch of personality. It's very rare that you just steadily have beta waves and then just alpha waves. It's usually a mixture. So when we talk about you having beta waves versus theta waves versus delta waves, we're talking about a majority. Like a majority of your brain right now is experiencing beta waves. And hopefully that's what you have right now as you're watching me, that you're wide awake and you're paying attention because you got beta waves going on. But if you're playing this in the background and you're just kind of relaxing and just kind of couch potatoing out right now, probably have some alpha, maybe even some theta. Yes! Hey, David's here. Not in Dr. Gerding's class. That's right, you're not in Dr. Gerding's class, because I'm not Dr. Gerding. I didn't avoid getting my PhD just so someone could call me doctor. Ha! Ha! But how do I remember the difference between beta, alpha, theta, delta? I think of this mnemonic device, if you will. It's almost an acronym, and that is bathed. You bathe in sleep. Think of it that way, bathe, where the B stands for beta, the A stands for alpha, or getting drowsy, the THE, the, stands for theta waves, all right, I'm asleep. And then once you get into deeper sleep, that's the D, delta. So hopefully that helps you know the difference between the different brain waves. Now I kind of teased a little bit about gamma waves. Gamma waves are extremely short wavelength. That's when you're intensely paying attention. Maybe you're even having a panic attack. That's very, very active beta waves. So it almost has its own ranking, gamma waves. But anyway, don't worry about gamma. That's just me showing off. You don't need to know that. Let's move on to the stages of sleep. There's two basic categories of stages of sleep. There's NREM and then there's REM, right? You got NREM usually happens first and then you have REM. What does NREM stand for? What does REM stand for? Rapid eye movement. So NREM stands for non-rapid eye movement, where REM stands for rapid eye movement. This isn't a clever name, by the way. It's called rapid eye movement because your eyes are moving rapidly. It's that simple. I just realized I don't need my headphones, so I just took them out, like, because there's no music or anything that I'm listening to. I'm not playing a video game today. Why are my headphones? But rapid eye movement. If you've ever been one of those creepers that watches someone sleep, you know that they're in REM sleep if you see them moving their eyelids while they're sleeping, because you can see the eyes moving behind the eyelids. But while you're sleeping, your eyelids move so fast, you can impersonate it. Like if you look as fast as you can left and right, you can't do it as fast as your eyes move back and forth while you're sleeping. They go, it's crazy. It's almost like they're having a seizure. And you can see that. I don't know why you're being a creeper and watching someone sleep, but that is the idea of rapid eye movement. Non-rapid eye movement sleep is what happens ahead of time and your eyes aren't moving rapidly. Now, non-rapid eye movement sleep has different stages. And if you're in my class and you have a test this week, I love matching sections, as do a lot of students. And the matching section on this test is all about the stages of sleep. So what I'm about to do is I'm about to give you all the answers to the matching section, because the matching section is all about the stages of sleep. I'm going to give you a bit of information, bloop, bloop, and then you match it to the stage of sleep. How many stages are there? Well, there's four stages of NREM, and then you got REM, right? Four stages of NREM, and then you got REM. So you have stage one NREM, stage two NREM, stage three NREM, stage four NREM, and then you've got REM. So here's a quick overview. If we look at this chart over here, shows you right here. This isn't asleep, so this isn't a stage of sleep. But when you're awake and paying attention, there you see the beta waves. Your brain's firing on all cylinders. And I almost want to think of the brain as a train, big locomotive engine. Because when you're awake and paying attention, it's full steam ahead. When you start getting drowsy, it's slowing down. That's alpha waves. And then once you start really slowing down, chugga, 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 that's when you get into the first stage of sleep. Stage one, theta waves start making a strong appearance. That's stage one of sleep. And this is a question that a lot of students get wrong on the test. It drives me crazy because I'll even ask, hey, what's the first stage of sleep signified by the appearance of theta waves? And some students get that question wrong. Your options are stage one, two, three, four, and REM. And I say, what's the first stage of sleep? Even if you didn't study, you should know that the first stage of sleep should be stage one. So anyway, so stage one, theta waves appear, right? That's stage one. You can have a whole bunch of hypnagogic hallucinations at that point, but not as much as you do when you're awake. What the heck are hypnagogic hallucinations? Keep your pants on, about to tell you. This is just your quick preview of the stages, and then we're going to take time going into detail for each one of these stages. Preview now, bigger details coming up. Stage two, you still have a lot of theta waves, but delta waves start making appearance. And you also have sleep spindles and K complexes. In fact, stage one and stage two look almost identical. It's just that you see sleep spindles and K complexes. Long story short, what are sleep spindles and K complexes? They're bursts of electrical activity, which oftentimes cause a little bit of twitching. So if you're that sleep creeper and you're watching someone sleep and you start seeing them twitch, you can say, stage two, NREM, non-rapid eye movement, carry on. And then once they're in what's known as deep sleep, also known as slow wave sleep, that's where stage three and four come in. Their brain is almost gone. It's barely active. That train, chugga, 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 chugga. Just so slow, so slow. And that's where a lot of interesting things happen. In fact, if you were going to cheat on this matching section, I shouldn't say cheat, if you had a guess on this matching section, most of the vocabulary terms and interesting things happen during slow wave sleep or REM sleep. So if you had a guess, either put REM or stage four is basically the two that you would have to guess. Like, I don't know the answer, better put REM because that's a guess. But if you look after stages three and stage four of this slow wave sleep, the brain boop, 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 goes back up these steps to REM. In fact, REM is also known as paradoxical sleep. Paradox. What is a paradox? Paradox are two clashing truths. This is true and this is true, but they don't really agree with one another. How can they both be true? And that's a paradox. So we call it paradoxical sleep. Why? Because you're asleep, but you have beta waves going on. And when do you normally have beta waves? When you're awake and paying attention. So what magical thing happens during REM sleep? The thing we like about sleep so much. Dreams. Boop. Dreams. You dream during REM sleep. Your eyes are moving rapidly during REM. And you are, you know what? Why don't we just get into the details? Because that was your preview. Let's get into the big details. That way I can explain what hypnagogic hallucinations are, etc. So first, we're starting with awake. This isn't the stages of sleep. This is what happens when you're awake. Onset of sleep. You're awake but drowsy. Your brain's electrical activity gears down. You're getting slower and slower brain waves. Your thoughts wander. They're less logical. But then you can have hypnagogic hallucinations, which often lead to a mild clonic jerk, more commonly known as a sleep start. Hypnagogic hallucination. What is hallucination? Hallucination is a fully immersive false sensation, right? You can have an auditory hallucination. Those are the most common when you think you hear something that's not there. A visual hallucination is what people mostly think of when they think of hallucinating, but they're not always visual. But visual is when you see something that's not there. So this is a hypnagogic hallucination, which is a fully immersive hallucination. You think you're there, smell, touch, taste, everything. And you're not even asleep yet, but you're somewhere else. You're hallucinating. And then a lot of times that can startle you, which leads to this myoclonic jerk. For instance, has this ever happened to you? You ever do this move where you're going, huh? This is an example of a myoclonic jerk. You ever do that? Huh? That sleep start? Where you, ah! I mean, it happened to me all the time when I was in grade school because I'd be falling asleep in class and I was never really smooth about hiding the fact that I was asleep in class because I'd have these hypnagogic hallucinations and then I'd have a myoclonic jerk, which would it be the sleep start that would make a whole bunch of noise and the class would laugh at me, etc. Wasn't a popular kid in grade school, probably because of all the sleep starts I had and the excessive weight I had. I was a fatty as a kid. Yeah. Had a bit of a weight problem growing up, but we'll talk more about that later on. The most common hypnagogic hallucination that people have that lead to a myoclonic jerk is missing a step. This is amazing research. People research in sleep studies, and when they had a myoclonic jerk, they'd say, what did you just hallucinate you were doing? And the most common answer was, I was walking down the stairs, and then I missed the last step. I thought, oh, I'm done walking down these stairs. Oh, whoops! But you weren't. That's the most common myoclonic jerk. Not sure, Not sure if you've ever experienced that. Ruben, you don't have to believe if I was a fatty or not. I don't know why I'd lie to you about that stuff, but you can see pictures of me as a kid, and you'd probably see, oh yeah, Professor Gerding was a fatty as a kid. Anyway, let's move on from awake, and let's get into stage one NREM. So stage one NREM, alpha brainwaves are replaced with even slower theta brainwaves. This signifies the first stage of sleep. It lasts only a few minutes. You gradually disengage from the world. The sounds that you hear go away. Instead of hearing my voice right now, as you slip off into sleep, it starts to sound up like this. And then you're gone. That's the idea. You can wake up right away if you need to. That's the cool thing about stage one. Because if I was sleeping in class and a teacher came by and said, Alan, you sleeping? I'd say, don't insult me. Of course I'm not sleeping. I'm wide awake. I was sleeping, but just barely, that kind of stuff. That's the idea of stage one. Now on your test, there's only one thing I'm going to potentially match up to stage one NREM, and that's appearance of theta waves signifying the first stage of sleep. That's it. If you got that, move on. You got stage one. That's all we need to know about stage one. So now we're going to move down into stage two. And PowerPoint's taking a while to load, and it's throwing me off my game. You're ruining my mojo. All right, there we go. So we've finished stage one. Now we got to go down to stage two. And again, stage two is basically the same as stage one. This time it lasts only 15 to 20 minutes, but here's the sleep spindles and K complexes, right? Specifically, sleep spindles are bursts of very short wavelength. So if you have theta waves going on and they kind of look like this, this is what a sleep spindle would look like. Sleep spindles. Show you another one. Here comes theta waves. Sleep spindle. That's a sleep spindle, which can lead to some twitching. K complexes, on the other hand, are a sudden burst of high amplitude. So they're usually located within a sleep spindle. So you have the theta waves, sleep spindle, pew, 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 K-complex. It was so high, my hand disappeared into the chat. Ah! Oh, my fingers. But that's the idea. So your theta waves, sleep spindle, K-complex, sleep spindle, theta waves, sleep spindle, theta waves, K-complex, theta waves, sleep spindle, theta waves. That's the idea of stage two. 15 to 20 minutes, and your breathing becomes rhythmic at this point. So you have very rhythmic breathing. All right, that's stage two. Exciting stuff. But now we get interesting. Because if you're that sleep creeper watching someone sleep, oh my, and you see them twitching, you realize they're in stage two. But a lot of people want their significant others to reach stages three and stage four of NREM. Why? Because some people believe, that if you are able to disturb someone's sleep, we're in stages three and four, where they're in deep sleep, slow wave sleep, a lot of delta waves going on, they don't have the brain power, the conscious brain power, to lie. So some people want to watch and wake them up during stage four of sleep so they can start interrogating them with questions. Now keep in mind, is there research that backs this up? Yes and no, not enough. All that to say, any information you get from interrogating someone who is in stages three and four of deep sleep is not admissible in court. So sorry. But realistically, it might be. It all boils down to how good your lawyer is. But anyway, let's get into this. Robin's here. Oh my goodness. Robin says, I have a sleep awakening questioning. When I wake up in the morning, I feel like I have foggy thoughts and songs stuck in my head. Why? It's a great question. It all has to do with sleep cycles. So what I'm going to ask you, Robin, is to stick a pin in it and ask it later on once we finish the stages of sleep and we talk about sleep cycles, because it should make sense. How groggy you feel when you wake up depends upon which stage of sleep was interrupted as you wake. Oh, ho, ho, ho. The plot thickens. But let's get there. Let's talk about stages three and four. They're so similar, we're going to group them together. Stages three and four of sleep both contain delta waves, and it lasts about 20 to 40 minutes. Again, this is known as slow wave sleep, also known as deep sleep. The difference is, stage 3, about 20% of your brain waves can be identified as delta waves. But in stage 4, it goes all the way to 50%. At least half of your brain waves are delta waves. You're gone. That locomotive is very slow. Very slow. Your heart rate, your blood pressure, your breathing rates are at their lowest. So if you're that creeper that is watching someone sleep, you can just look at their chest, and if you see it rising and falling and it's going super slow, you know they probably are at stages 3 and 4. If you ever watch like a dog sleep, it's kind of impressive. You watch their chest rise as they inhale, just goes. Like they have really slow breathing cycles. It's incredible. Pay attention to how fast you're breathing right now. Inhale, exhale. On average, someone's like 2-3 seconds for each inhale, 2-3 seconds for each exhale. But when you're sleeping, it can go to like 30 seconds of inhaling, 30 seconds of exhaling. It's incredible. Which, as we get later on with sleep problems, is a problem with sleep apnea. But we'll get there. I'm getting too excited. Man, I love this stuff. I just want to just inject you with all the information because it's so cool. Stages 3 and 4, slow wave sleep, whole bunch of interesting things happen. The sleeper is oblivious to the world, but your muscles are still capable of movement, which means you are capable of sleepwalking. You're capable of sleepwalking. And this is very common. Everyone sleepwalks. And all the time I get students that say, BS, lies, I don't sleepwalk. Yes, you do. Because what is the most common thing people do when they sleepwalk? Go to the bathroom. There's probably times at night where you wake up and you go to the bathroom, come back, fall asleep. You never remember getting up and going to the bathroom. You ever fall asleep on the couch, but then wake up in the bed and wonder, how the heck did I end up in my bed? I thought I fell asleep on the couch. What's the answer? It's me. It's Professor Gerding. I moved you. I watched you when you fell asleep. Opened up the window. Stepped through. Snuck to you. Lifted you up. Took you to your bed. Put you down. Tuck you in. Come back out the window. Good night.
No, it's sleepwalking. That's what happened. You just had slow wave sleep that your brain didn't even realize what was going on. There's this idea that, oh, you should never wake up a sleepwalker. 110% bullcrap. Because first of all, you won't even tell that someone is sleepwalking. You can't even tell because they seem normal. You'd see someone and you'd ask like, hey, what are you doing? Going to the bathroom. Oh, okay. And then you ask them the next day like, man, you seemed really out of it when you were going to the bathroom last night. What are you talking about? Has that ever happened to you? Anyone ever say like, hey, you were really out of it last night when we were talking on the phone. I didn't talk to you on the phone. Then you look at your phone records and you realize, oh my goodness, we did. That's sleepwalking. Anytime that you are engaging in activity, but your brain is in delta waves and you're not there and you don't remember it happening, that's sleepwalking. It happens all the time, especially as kids. And this is usually when I tell the Oreo story because it takes 15 minutes or longer to regain full wakeful consciousness. Meaning you could be totally sound asleep and if you're in stage 4 and something starts waking you up, you can actually get up and move around, but it will take you 15 minutes before your hippocampus starts activating and your conscious awareness starts happening and you're actually self-aware. Meaning there are times that you've been awake for like 10, 15 minutes and you wake up in the shower, even though that you've been up and ambulatory. It's not until the shower you're like, man, I don't even remember hitting the alarm. How did I do this? You were just on autopilot until you got into that shower. You could be in a war zone, in a foxhole. Explosions going everywhere. You get up, start killing people, not even remember it because you were in slow wave sleep, stages 3 and 4. Okay, so Oreo story. Story time. Hope you enjoy this one. I was an overweight child and I remember my mom too. My mom, some people criticize my mom for saying this. Some people praise my mom for saying this, but I remember she sat me down at one point when I was a child and said, Alan, I'm your mother And it's my job more than anyone else's to let you know if you're fat. And Alan, you're fat. You need to lose weight. And she restricted my Oreo intake because I loved Oreos. She'd buy Oreos, double stuffed Oreos, and she said, you're down to 3 Oreos a day. You can only eat 3 Oreos a day. And that was torture to me. But man, I remember being on the bus on the way home from school. And then when the bus driver would open that door, I'd waddle my fat ass up the driveway. And I'd come in, and the first 2 Oreos I would devour right away in a ravenous haze. I almost feel sorry for those Oreos. But the 3rd Oreo, I'd realize this is my last one of the day. I have to savor it. So I would do the thing where I twist it off. And I would do different things depending on the day. I'd experiment. Sometimes I would dip it. Sometimes I'd eat like half of the frosting, rake it on the teeth. That maneuver. Just savor it. Sometimes I get peanut butter. Oh my, that was a good way of cheating the system. Dip it in the peanut butter. Oh, I love you, Oreo. But she restricted my Oreo intake. Which is why I was so upset the night Michael Ferrone spent the night. So I was probably, man, what was I like? 4 years old, 5, fat 4, 5-year old. My brother, he was 8, my older brother, Chris. And he had his best friend, Mike Ferrone, spend the night. And this is like the first time we had another kid spend the night at our house. So it was a big deal. Because we had other kids come over plenty of times. But this blew my mind as a young child. Like, wait a second, what? You're telling me that not only is Michael Ferrone going to be here today hanging out with us, but he'll be here tomorrow morning. He's going to have like Cinnamon Toast Crunch with us in the morning cereal together. Like, he's still going to be here. I'm like, what? And I was a typical little brother because I followed my older brother and Mike Ferrone everywhere. Me too, guys. Me too, right? Yes, you too. Like they decided to go for a walk in the woods. Me too, right? Yes, you too. So my little fat ass would have to, oh, wait up, guys. Try to keep up with them. They would play video games, right? Like, me too, guys, right? Me too. Yeah. And my brother was such a good older brother. He would actually, like, let me share Luigi with him. Like, Michael Ferrone would be Mario, and then Luigi, my brother, would take a turn. And then when he dies, like, all right, your turn. So, me too, yay. And so when it was time for bedtime, I was like, me too, guys, right? Me too. Yeah, you too. So I remember I dragged my Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle sleeping bag, which was like Eastman and Laird's Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. It was the one with the red bandanas. So it's probably worth something nowadays, but I have no idea where it went. Probably thrown away after this disgusting kid ruined it. But I dragged it into my brother's room, and my brother had a bed, and it was a trundle bed. So it had the bed where my brother slept, and then it had this drawer bed that would pull out, and that's where Mike slept, and then I slept on the floor. And I remember saying, hey guys, if I fall asleep and you start doing something fun, you'll wake me up, right? Yes, we'll wake you up. Me too, guys, right? Me too. Yes, you too. So I fell asleep right away. In fact, I'm not sure if you picked this up, but I'm a really good sleeper. So I just was out like a light. It's out. And then I woke up in the morning and I was pissed. So angry. Why was I angry? Because I saw that Michael and my brother, Chris, had an Oreo party without me. And I already said, I loved me some Oreos. This is before my mom restricted my Oreo intake diet, or maybe during it. I don't know. It doesn't matter. Timeline doesn't matter. But all I knew was that I saw the double stuffed Oreo container totally empty. And I was angry. So I walked up to my brother as he slept and I slapped him awake. Oh, what was that for? So that was for having an Oreo party without me. You said me too. You said me too. In fact, I want to make this dramatic, so I'm going to go into OBS here and I'm going to make my screen bigger. Look at this. Yeah. You said me too. You said me too. And I'll never forget what my brother said. My brother said, us? That was you. And my brother claimed that I had, after they had been talking for about 90 minutes, sat up, got out of my sleeping bag, walked out of the door, out of the room, walked downstairs into the kitchen, grabbed the Oreo cookie containers, brought them back into the room, and started eating them at a frightful rate. Hum, nom, 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 hum, nom, nom. And when he said that, us, that was you. That's when I noticed that I had all these crumbs on me. And I assumed that they had just played a joke and that they had put just crumbs. I'm like, oh, he's going to be mad that we ate all the Oreo cookies. Let's put crumbs on him so we can just say he joined us. And it was for years that I thought that they were playing a trick on me and just lied to me and had an Oreo party. It wasn't until my introductory psychology class when I learned about sleepwalking and specifically sleep eating disorders that I realized, oh my goodness, this totally could be true. Because the one mystery I could never figure out was how they got the Oreo cake in my teeth too, because I definitely still had Oreo cake in my teeth when I woke up. But the real impressive thing to me, now knowing the neuroscience between sleepwalking, how it's very common for kids that are younger than 8 years of age, very common for children under the 8 years of age mark to have sleep disorders. Very common for them to sleepwalk, to have urinesis, etc. But I am impressed that even though I only had about 50% delta waves going on, my brain was barely processing, I still had the wherewithal to go downstairs, grab the Oreos, and not eat them there, but say, me too, me too. And then come back up and eat the Oreos with Michael and Chris. So even though I was half dead in the brain, still knew that I wanted to be with the party. Amazing. Robin says, that's like an M. Night Shyamalan movie. What a twist! Woo! Yeah, I ate all the cookies. I ate all the remaining cookies. Let's see. May says, Carrier mother, she's the only one in this fake world who really loves you more than others. I love my mom, but I will say, that's kind of what upsets me about my mom in hindsight. Like, I don't want to throw any shade at my mom, because I love her, and she's amazing. Just saw her last night, it was a great visit. But, if it was such a problem, why are you buying the Oreos, mom? Instead of torturing me with just 3 Oreos a day, stop bringing them into the house. As an adult, I know I have poor impulse control. So as an adult, I have to just make sure I don't even buy the stuff. If I don't want to eat the ice cream, don't even buy the ice cream. Because I can't moderate. An open ice cream container is an empty ice cream container. I can't just be like, oh, that's good, I'm done. I'm not done until I feel miserable and hate myself. I'm not done until there's nothing left but crumbs and disorder. I can't just be like, that's enough for now because I want to be full. Full doesn't really resonate with me. I just have to stop once my plate is empty. And sure enough, that's another thing my mom did. She was part of that clean plate clan. Like, you don't leave until that plate's clean. I still see some food on the plate. Gotta make sure that every little drop was gone off my plate. Otherwise, she would guilt me. So I never learned to just simply leave food alone once I was full. It's just like a Tasmanian devil over here. Yeah, I wasn't buying the Oreos. Thanks, Mom. Thanks. All right, so that's the Oreo story. Oh my goodness. Do I still love Oreos to this day? Yes, it's a weakness. Yes, an open container is an empty container. Get them away from me. Get them away from me because I will enjoy them too much. But that's the stages of 3 and 4. Sleepwalking is the main vocabulary term that you want to match up to stage 4 and stage 3, right? So let's go into REM sleep, right? REM sleep, last stage of sleep, REM. So upon reaching stages 4 and about after 80 to 100 minutes of total sleep time, meaning if you're going to be that creeper and interview your significant other, you have to do it before they hit REM. You want to make sure they're in sleepwalking area of deep, slow wave sleep. Because if you wait too long, you're going to get them in REM. So you have about, you know, that whole hour and a half, so a little bit less, hour and a half before you get to REM sleep. Sleep lightens, returns through stages 3, 2, 1, and eventually you get to beta waves, and that's when REM sleep occurs. Muscles are their most relaxed. Wait, what? This is when dreams occur. Your body has a self-protective mechanism that when you're dreaming, it paralyzes you. Boom! It literally shuts off your muscular system. Why would it do that? Why would your body turn off your muscle, paralyze you? Why would your body paralyze you during REM sleep so you don't act out your dreams? Because if you're having a dream that you're slaying a dragon and you're not paralyzed, you're standing there. It's not like you jump out of your bed and you're coordinated and doing this. You're just thrashing all about in your sleep. Do you think there's a sleep disorder where people aren't paralyzed when they're in REM sleep? Yes. It's called REM sleep behavior disorder. Do those people have problems? Yes, they wake up with bruises and potential danger to their body. There's one thing they can't do, and I'll ask you that later on once we cover this again. But right, let's get back on to REM sleep. So it paralyzes you. That's when your eyes are moving rapidly and dreams occur and you have those beta waves. That's REM sleep. That's a lot of things you could match up on the exam. So if I say muscles are the most relaxed, REM sleep. Beta waves, REM sleep, as long as awake and paying attention isn't an option. Rapid eye movement, REM sleep. You definitely shouldn't get that one wrong. REM sleep, rapid eye movement, eyes move rapidly. Don't get that one wrong. Don't be that student. And then dreams, REM sleep. REM sleep, fascinating stuff. And those are your stages of sleep. But here's my question. If we look at these stages, look at this. You got stage 1, 2, 3, 4, which lasts about 70 minutes, less than an hour and a half. And then 5 to 15 minutes, that's at most 85 minutes, less than an hour and a half. Once you've been sleeping for an hour and a half, what happens then? Do you wake up? Do you wake up after only 85, 90 minutes of sleep? No, no. You do it all over again. And that's what a sleep cycle is. You have 4 or 5 sleep cycles occur in a typical night's sleep, which averages out to be about that 8 hours of sleep. If you do the math, that's about 8 hours. But here's what's interesting. Each of those sleep cycles look different. You spend more and more time in REM sleep and less time in NREM sleep, which means when you look at this here, that REM sleep grows and comes closer to me, and the NREM sleep shrinks. So when your alarm goes off in the morning and you've had your full 7, 8 hours of sleep, it means that that alarm is most likely going to interrupt a dream and you shouldn't have a hard time waking up right away. However, if that alarm goes off and you're not getting enough sleep, it's more likely to catch you during NREM. And when your sleep is interrupted during the NREM stages, that's what causes that nap hangover feeling, that almost jet lag feeling of Now there's other issues, there's dietary issues, there's other issues that go in, like how much are you exercising, et cetera, how tired you feel when you wake up, besides what stage of sleep is interrupted, but what stage of sleep is interrupted is definitely one of those factors. So those are the sleep cycles. Let me check out the chat. All right. So yes, my brother and Michael Ferrone just sat there and watched me scarf down all those Oreos. They may have been afraid to take any, according to the incredible rate at which I ate those Oreos. It's pretty scary. So Robin says, if I'm buying something, I will eat all of it that day. My brain won't let me leave it be. Robin, you and me, peas in a pod. I've said it once, I'll say it again. You and me, we're in this. You and me have a lot in common. I think our personalities really are there. And Oreos are vegan, absolutely. So delta waves is the sleepwalking. Yes, David. So delta waves, that's when you sleepwalk. Your brain is suppressed. It's basically barely active, but your body isn't paralyzed because you can't sleep during REM. I'm sorry. You can't move during REM because your body's paralyzed. So sleepwalking while you're dreaming, not possible. That's why it's also really frustrating, because in so many movies and television shows, they depict sleeping all wrong. They'll show someone tossing and turning like, no, this, you can't, not there, don't go for it. And then they show them, them dreaming. And so they're acting out like their dream. That typically does not happen. When you're dreaming, you're there. However, sleep talking is very common. And that happens during stage 4. My father, huge sleep talker, hilarious. He's made many people laugh with his sleep talking, but a lot of times it's interactive. And that shows you that it's more sleepwalking than it is REM, because it's that interactive. I'll never forget one of the funniest times. I was watching television and he was asleep on the couch behind me. That man sleeps more on the couch in front of the television than any bed in his life, period. Like, I'm not lying. But I'm watching, and 90210 was on. Ba-na-na-na, 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 ba-na-na-na. And for some reason, Brenda was in the hospital and Dylan McKay comes running in like all concerned. Oh, because they were dating at the time. He's like, oh my goodness, What's wrong with her? What's wrong with her? And he's talking to Brendan, her twin brother. What's wrong with her? And my father, who's dead asleep behind us, goes, it's cancer. It's definitely cancer. Hilarious. Everyone laughed. It's brilliant. Thanks, Dad, for all the laughs. Yeah. Apparently, David, you nailed it. Okay, sleep talking and laughing, totally know about. This makes me feel good. My partner has told me that I am a sleep laugher, which makes me happy to know that. So apparently I'll just be sleeping. That's probably not how I laugh, but I laugh in my sleep. It's good. It's nice. Nice to know that I'm happy even in my sleep. Any questions on this? Oh, here's the question that a lot of people usually want to know is, again, like, how do I know when to interrupt my significant other? Again, you watch the twitching. You're almost there. That's stage two. Then you wait for the very slow breathing. And you got to do it probably after like an hour of sleep. And that's when you can disturb them. Hey, wake up. What? What? And ideally, they're in slow wave sleep and they don't have the brain power to be creative and lie. Hey, are you cheating on me? What do you mean? Are you having sex with anyone else? Yes. What? Who are you sleeping with? Sarah. What? Who's Sarah? She's the receptionist at work. Oh my goodness. How long's this been going on? I don't know. Years. What? Oh my goodness. How could you do this to me? With my penis. That's the idea of being incredibly honest. But there's no guarantees that that will actually happen. But those are the stages of sleep. And that is the matching section on your test. And I hope that helps you and you're ready to kick butt on your test. Now, does everyone sleep the same amount? Does everyone feel the same amount of sleepiness? No, some people are sleep babies. Some people don't sleep much at all. So there's individual differences in sleep drive. Some individuals need more and some less than the typical 8 hours per night. Some people, every night by clockwork, they just go to bed at a specific time, they sleep exactly 8 hours, and they wake up. There's a whole bunch of correlational issues. Correlation isn't causation, remember, of not getting enough sleep. Obesity, cancer, heart issues, etc. You should be getting 8 hours. However, it was probably about a decade ago now. If I was a better teacher, I would have found the literature and brought this up. There is some research that suggests, yes, it's 8 hours, but those 8 hours don't have to be consecutive. That realistically, especially when we keep in mind our circadian rhythms of being sleepy around 3 o'clock, human beings are designed to be nappers. That we have one long session at night and then a small session throughout the day. So I think that I get my 8 hours, but I'm a big napper. So realistically, I get about 6 to 7 hours and then 1 hour of napping every day. And that gets me to my 7-8 hour limit. And I feel great. And I've always been a big napper. So if you're a napper too, good for you. Supposedly very healthy. Yeah, some people seem to function well on 4 hours of sleep. And this comes in the difference between non-somniacs and insomniacs. So this is a question that is typically in every test that I make. What is the difference between a non-somniac and insomniac? And the most common incorrect answer that students provide is, well, an insomniac doesn't get any sleep. Wrong. A non-somniac doesn't get much sleep either. The difference is the non-somniac is fine. Non-somniac functions very well with very little sleep. Insomniac, they don't get much sleep, but they're in hell. They're miserable. They're in pain. Insomniac in hell. Insomniac is insufferable. They are not happy. Ugh. I want to sleep, but I can't. Ugh, that's insomnia. Non-somniac, very little sleep. I'll never forget, I had one student when I was teaching this. One student in the back corner said, I'm a non-somniac. And I said, hey, Gus, I don't want to insult you or call you out here. I'm very confident that you're not a non-somniac. What was it about Gus that made me so confident that he was not a non-somniac? Simple. He slept during my class all the time. Now, I may not be the best teacher or the most engaging teacher, but if you're a non-somniac and you're supposed to stay awake during my class, I think you wouldn't have a hard time staying awake. But because he slept in my class all the time, it made me think that unless he's only getting his sleep in my class, he wasn't a non-somniac. All right, let me check some of these comments here. They're scrolling through. Let's see, siestas. Most Europeans take a midday nap and then have a late dinner. Yeah, I'm a big siesta person. Pretty sure that's not most Europeans, mostly Spain, says Ruben, probably. I'm just a stupid American. I don't know all the cultures, but yeah, I have heard siestas being a cultural thing in Spain. And I've heard some Italians talk about siestas. And I've heard, and this is heard, I haven't read or researched or witnessed, so it could totally be wrong, that there's some European cultures, like Italian cultures, that it's very common for businesses to be closed like in the middle of the day, where they have like rolling hours where you may show up and the store's closed for a little bit because they're taking a break. It may not be a siesta, but instead of being like open all the time from 8 to 6, it's just like, hey, we're open sometimes before the hours of 7 or whatever. And you just hopefully you catch them. But for us Americans, of having that regular mass market hours of schedule, that's very frustrating for us to really even appreciate. Anyway, we're almost out of time here because it's already 2 o'clock. We didn't have time to talk about the sleep disorders. So why don't we come back next time, tomorrow, on the Adventures of Fun at One, and we'll talk all about the sleep disorders. You want to talk about sleep apnea? Heck yeah, we'll talk about it. Sleep paralysis? Yeah. Urinesis? Oh my. Cataplexy? What the heck's cataplexy? Well, have you ever heard of narcolepsy? Oh my goodness. No, that's not having sex with dead people, you silly person. That's an incontrollable urge to rest. And we'll talk about that and some of the other sleep disorders next time at Fun at One. I can't wait. I'll see you tomorrow. And don't forget, next week will be multiplayer week. We'll probably start with Mario Kart Monday. On Monday of next week, we'll play some Mario Kart. We've got Duck Game. Want to play some Duck Game? There's Rocket League. Not sure if we'll play Rocket League or not. I need some feedback. Let me know what multiplayer games we're going to play, because we're definitely going to do Mario Kart. We're definitely going to do Duck Game. We're definitely going to do Bomberman, because that's free. What else are we going to do? I need a fourth. What's the fourth game we're going to play? We got Mario Kart, Duck Game, Bomberman. What's the fourth? Let me know. All right. Have fun, everyone. I hope you have an amazing week. Hope you're doing well. I always love seeing you. Until next time, have fun. Tomorrow at 1. Walking away. Yeah, but on my way.